Morning, everybody. As Mahen said, we are starting a new series, and it's called I Am. If you look in the book of John, there's seven statements that Jesus makes about himself. And so we're going to be working through one statement over the next 7 weeks. And we were just chatting, I was looking, okay, where are we going for the next couple of weeks? And it just so works out that on the seventh Sunday is Christmas. And on that day, we're working through Jesus, the light of the world. So I think it just worked out perfectly that we're working through this. You know, many people have had their opinion about who Jesus is or Jesus was. You can go and Google what celebrities have thought about Jesus. You know, you can go and see what Mahatma Gandhi thought about Jesus, what Bono thought about Jesus, what Justin Bieber thinks about Jesus, what all sorts of celebrities think about Jesus. Kanye West more recently thinks about Jesus. There's all these guys who got this opinion about who Jesus is. In fact, even in the Bible, there's this one instance where Jesus asks his disciples. He says, hey, who do you say I am? Who do people say I am? And they're like, some people say John the Baptist or Elijah or Jeremiah or one of the prophets. And so this morning, we're going to be looking at what does Jesus say about himself? Who does he say he is? Isn't that the best person to ask, right? Not ask anybody else. You just go to the man. Say, who do you say you are? You know? And then you'll get the answer. I don't go to anybody else and ask, who do you say who Tulani is? Because I'll get all sorts of things. And some of them maybe Tulani doesn't want to hear. Maybe some of them he does want to hear. But we're going to the source. Who does Jesus say that he is? And so like I said, we're going to be in the next 7 weeks. So Jesus, we're going to cover things like Jesus, I'm the good shepherd. He says, I'm the good shepherd. I'm the light of the world. I'm the way, the truth, and the life. And this morning, we're going to be looking at where Jesus says, I am the bread of life. I'm the bread of life. Who likes bread? Hands up. Come on now. None of this panting, non-GMO, whatever nonsense. Proper white bread from Spar. Who likes proper white bread from Spar? So I remember as a kid, you growing up, and before sliced bread, there was none of the, although they got those funny machines, remember those machines you had to use? So you get this loaf of bread that's steaming still, you pop it on in this machine, you know, goes through the machine, you take it out the other side, put it on the top, take the crust off, eat the crust, and then you put your, you know, fresh bread. This is something about fresh bread. I introduced my kids a couple of years ago, and quite recently, to that whole idea of unsliced fresh bread from Spar or from the shops. There's just something about slicing a big doorstop of bread, lots of butter, strawberry jam, and it's just one of those, and you sort it for a while. Everybody loves bread, but bread is such a simple thing, though. Jesus says, I am the bread of life. And so, just as we're worshiping, even this morning, we sang, Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. And I pray that it's more than just words that we sing. We, in our hearts, we're saying, Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. And not just in this building, you're welcome in my heart. You're welcome to come and have your way. You can come and speak, and I'm trusting that God would come as we sang. You sung it with your own lips. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. And I pray that it's true in our hearts. We're saying, God, you are welcome. You are welcome to come and speak into my life. And I pray that God would speak to us today through this passage. We're going to be in the book of John chapter 6. If you've got a smartphone or Facebook, please, Vernon. No, I'm joking. if you've got a phone or a tablet or your Bible, the scriptures are going to come on the screen. But we're going to, a key verse for me, out of this whole passage is John 6, verse 35. And Jesus says this of himself. He says, Jesus replied, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry again. And whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. That's what Jesus says about himself. And so what had happened, we're going to work through from the beginning. Well, what had happened up to that point was Jesus started gathering a huge crowd. A lot of people started following him. And if you look back, maybe if you read earlier on in the book of John, there's this massive crowd. And if you were in that crowd that day when Jesus was saying that he is the bread of life, you're on the side of this mountain. There's the Bible says about 5,000 men. They estimate between 15,000 to 20,000 people. So they only counted the men, 5,000 men If you add the women and children, maybe 15 to 20,000 people on the side of a mountain. If you were in that crowd, maybe you were there for a number of reasons. Maybe you were there when Jesus turned the water into wine at that wedding. Maybe you went to that wedding and the wine ran out, and the next thing, Jesus turns this water into wine, and you're like, dude, this is amazing. This is incredible. Who is this guy? Jesus. Okay, I'm going to go and follow him. I'm going to go see what he's up to. Or maybe you were there with the woman at the well. Maybe you were in the town where the woman at the well lived, and she comes running into town saying, I met a guy who's told me everything about my life. And you're like, what? Let me go see this guy. And you run after and you go and start following Jesus. Maybe you were with that guy. Maybe you were when Jesus healed the official's son. Maybe you were a worker or a slave in the house, and Jesus comes in and he heals this official's son. Or maybe you were there, that guy that Jesus healed at the pool. Maybe you were the guy who cleans the pool, scrubbing the pool, checking out the creepy crawly, whatever, and this guy's been there for years and years and years. Jesus comes along and he heals him, and you're like, I'm out of here. I'm going to go and follow Jesus. So there's this massive crowd. So we're going to pick it up, John chapter 6 from verse 1. So after all this had happened, after all these healings, you can imagine people are starting to follow Jesus. After this, Jesus crossed over to the far side of the Sea of Galilee, also known as the Sea of Tiberias. A huge crowd kept following him wherever he went. Why? Because they saw his miraculous signs as he healed the sick. Then Jesus climbed the hill and sat down with his disciples around him. It was nearly time for the Jewish Passover celebration. Jesus soon saw a huge crowd of people coming to look for him. Turning to Philip, he asked, where can we buy bread to feed all these people? He was testing Philip, for he already knew what he was going to do. Philip replied, even if we worked for months, we wouldn't have enough money to feed them. So there's this picture, Jesus sitting there, he's hanging out with his disciples, Philip is next to him. Philip is from the area, so Jesus is like, hey dude, listen, look at all these people, where do you reckon we can get some food to feed all these guys? And Philip was obviously, this is not going to happen. There's like 15,000 people here. You know, you'll have to, it's a half a year's wages. And where are we going to get the money from? Plus, I don't even know if there's enough bread in town to feed all these people. Then, verse 8, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, spoke up. There's a young boy here with 5 barley loaves and 2 fish. But what good is that with a huge crowd? So now he overhears his conversation. Now imagine that, 15,000 people. You find a little boy who's got 5 pieces of bread and 2 fish. I wouldn't even bother, you know? I wouldn't, you know when you're clubbing in to buy food and you got your mates, how much have you got, how much have you got? Oh, I got 43 cents, you know, whatever. That's not gonna help me much, you know? Or you wanna tip a car guard. You know, sometimes you wanna tip a car guard and you like look in your wallet and you got like 70 cents and you're almost like embarrassed to give it to the guy. You know, like, thanks, but this is all I got. It's like that, you know? 15,000 people, 5 loaves of bread, 2 fish. If I was, I would have said, oh, sorry, dude, this is not gonna happen. But then Jesus says, he's got a plan, verse 10. Tell everyone to sit down, Jesus said. So they all sat down on the grassy slopes. Their men alone numbered about 5,000. Then Jesus took the loaves, gave thanks to God, and distributed them to the people. Afterward, he did the same with the fish. And they all ate as much as they wanted. After everyone was full, Jesus told his disciples, "Now gather the leftovers so that nothing is wasted." So they picked up the pieces and filled 12 baskets with scraps left by the people who had eaten from the 5 barley. Disciples, you get given a basket, you get given a piece of a piece of a piece of a piece of bread. It's in your basket. And Jesus says, okay, now I'm going, go and give it to all these people. I'll be like, okay, I don't know what's gonna happen. You stick your hand in the basket, you pull it out, and there's a piece of bread, okay? That's the only one I got. You give it to somebody. And now that person's hungry, you stick your hand, oh my goodness, there's another piece. You stick your hand in, it just keeps coming until everybody's fed. I mean, imagine being part of that miracle, right? I mean, Jesus could have just did it himself. He could have just said, hey, have some bread. There we go, have some fish. Done. But he involves his disciples. He involves the very people close to him. And then not only with that, with a fish is the same. Pull out a piece of a piece of a piece of a fish, give it to the person. You're like, okay, is there going to be any more? There's another one. It just keeps coming, you know. In fact, the Bible says that they all ate until they were full. Full. Dick. Lekker. Finish. Everybody's full. And then there were still 12 baskets of leftover. It's an amazing, amazing miracle. Then, verse 14, when the people saw him do this miraculous sign, they exclaimed, surely he is the prophet we have been waiting or expecting. When Jesus saw that they were ready to force him to be their king, he slipped away into the hills by himself. So then after this happens, Jesus slips away. He goes away, presumably to pray. Yeah, I don't know, maybe to go and pray. Shame, when Emily was young, very, very young, she used to say, Dad, will you please come and play with me? So then I'd go to her and I'd say, okay, Lord Jesus. No, Dad, not pray with me, play with me. So Jesus went to go and pray. Okay, maybe, we don't know. But his disciples jump in a boat. They start heading across the lake. Halfway across, this massive storm comes. They are freaking out. They are scared. They don't know what to do. Then they see a ghost. Well, it's Jesus, but they think it's a ghost. Now they're freaking out even more. Jesus says, chill, Oaks. It's me. It's Jesus. He jumps in the boat with them. And then the next thing, they're on the other side of the boat, other side of the lake. We'll pick it up in verse 25. So now the crowd can't find him. They're like, they wake up the next morning. I need some bread. I need some fish. Where's Jesus? Where's his disciples? They're gone. So they go and look for Jesus. Then they go across the lake themselves. Verse 25. They found him on the other side of the lake and asked him, Rabbi, when did you get here? Like as if they really want to know when he got there. They, you know, ulterior motives. When did you get here? You know, like this conversation. So what's happening? How you doing? You know, when did you get here? Jesus replies, he just gets straight to the point. Eh? I'll tell you the truth. You want to be with me because I fed you. And that's the truth, right? You want to be with me because I gave you food yesterday. I fed you. Not because you understood the miraculous sign. There was a sign that Jesus was pointing to. There was something greater and deeper that Jesus was doing. He wasn't just feeding hungry people. He wasn't just saying, are you guys hungry? Oh, here's some bread. You thirsty? Here's some water. There was something else that God was doing at that moment. It wasn't just, you know, filling people's stomachs with food and saying, okay, there you go, be blessed. There was something else that Jesus was doing. There was something else that he was pointing to, and they didn't see it. They couldn't see it. He said, you want to be with me because I fed you, not because you understood the miraculous signs. Verse 27, but don't be so concerned about perishable things like food. Spend your energy seeking the eternal life that the Son of Man can give you. For God the Father has given me the seal of his approval. And so there's more. I can feed you today with bread. But you know what? Tomorrow morning you're going to wake up and you're going to be hungry again. Then I'm going to give you some more bread. And you'll be fine for a bit, and then you're going to be hungry again. You're going to eat hungry, eat hungry, eat hungry. It's just, there's more that I want to do in your life. Verse 28, they say, we want to perform God's works too. What should we do? We also want to, you know, what should we study? What university should we go to? What theological book should we read? Or, you know, what degree should we get? Or who should I follow? All these things. What should we do? Jesus told them, this is the only work God wants from you, is to believe in the one he has sent, is to believe in Jesus. That was the work, is to believe in who Jesus said he was. And for us, is to believe who Jesus says he is, to believe in who he says he is. They answered, aha, this is dumb, eh? Anyway, verse 30, show us a miraculous sign if you want us to believe in you. You know, what can you do? I'm like, where have you been the last few days, Oaks? Didn't you see what I did, you know? They've just seen these amazing miracles. And the thing is, Jesus could have done miracle after miracle after miracle after miracle after miracle, and they still wouldn't have believed. God, if you only do this, I'll believe. God does it. You believe maybe 2-3 days. Then it's doubting again. God does a miracle in your life, you believe, and then you know, it's like a this wave of, if only you do this for me, I'll believe in you. If you do this for me, I'll trust you. If you do this for me, I'll follow you. Show us a sign, they say. Verse 31. Then they go on to say, after all, our ancestors ate manna while they journeyed through the wilderness. They're saying, huh, you know, you gave us bread for like one day. Moses gave us bread for 40 years. Beat that. That's what they were saying. Literally, they were saying that. Moses looked after us for 40 years, you know. Our ancestors ate manna while they journeyed through the wilderness. The scriptures say Moses gave them bread from heaven to eat. And you remember that in Exodus chapter 6. Exodus chapter 6, God had just rescued his people. They had literally just gone through the Red Sea. They'd just seen a miracle, okay? The Red Sea opens up. They all go through the Red Sea. They get to the other side, and the first thing they do is they grumble. We hungry. We thirsty. You know when your kids are like, you got a little five-year-old, six-year-old kid, you know? I'm hungry. I'm thirsty. How long is it till we get there? You know, it's like, literally, that's how the Israelites were. But you know, we like that too. We can mock them and we can, you know, comment about them, but we're the same sometimes. We see God's faithfulness and we moan and we grumble. Anyway, so Exodus 6, God had just taken them through the Red Sea. They get across, they start moaning, oh, I wish we were back in Egypt, eating meat around these pots and just it was magic. And they've forgotten all about the other nonsense. So God says, okay, I'll provide for you. I mean, how gracious is God? He says, I'll provide for you. And he gives them manna. You know, manna means, what is it? Because when they saw it, they were like, what is it? So that's what the word manna means, is what is it? It's like, whatchamacallit, you know? Hey, you want to come over to my house for, we're going to have some whatchamacallit. Okay, cool. That's what it was. What is it? It was called, what is it? Because they didn't really know what it was. But God provided for them. Every morning they would wake up in the morning and there was manna on the ground. And they would collect enough for them and their family and they would be sustained for the whole day. And the next day they wake up, they got no food. They go outside, God's provided manna. And that happened time and time again. Then they say, oh God, we're thirsty. You know, how's about something to drink? God's like, okay, go to that rock, strike the rock, water comes out. So God gives them bread from heaven and water from a rock. Let's get back to the book of John. So can you start seeing how they're tying together the God's bread from heaven in Exodus and now bread from heaven in the book of John? So Jesus said in verse 32, he says, I tell you the truth, Moses didn't give you the bread from heaven. It wasn't Moses, it was my Father. My Father gave you that bread from heaven. And now, listen to what Jesus says, and now he offers you the true bread from heaven. The true bread of God is the one who comes down from heaven and gives life to the world. Sir, they said, give us that bread every day. And so that's what Jesus was saying. You know what? They didn't realize who was actually in front of them. They didn't realize that this was the true bread that had come from heaven. The eternal Son of God, the one who could heal them, deliver them, save them, had a plan for their lives, had a destiny for their lives. He was going to lead them, love them, shepherd them, care for them. He could have set them free, delivered them, saved them, and all of that. And they ask him, hey, how's about some bread? Like, really? Is that what you want? Some bread? Because tomorrow you're going to be hungry again. So they still didn't get it. So Jesus spells it out for them. Okay, guys, you don't get it. Let me tell you what it is. Verse 35, Jesus replied, I am the bread of life. It's me. That manna was pointing to me. And just, although that manna only lasted for a day, you were hungry the next day. If you feed on me, if you eat on me, it will sustain you for your whole life. I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry again. Never be hungry again. Never be hungry again. And I just want to say that not that you're never going to be hungry, but you've got to ask yourself, if I'm feeling hungry, you know, you're hungry because you haven't eaten, right? And maybe you're here right now and that's where you are. You're not hearing a word I say. You're just thinking about that leftover bra meat that you had from yesterday. You're going to get home and warm it up. Okay. I don't know. I hope you're not doing that. I never do that. And I want to say this. When you're hungry because you haven't eaten, right? It's quite simple. You're hungry because you haven't eaten. And I think spiritually is the same. If we're feeding spiritually hungry, it's because you're not eating from the right source. You're not eating from the right place. You're not being sustained. That's what I want to remind us of today. Jesus says, whoever comes to me will never be hungry again. Jesus is saying, whatever hunger you have, I can satisfy. Whatever hunger you have, a hunger for affirmation, a hunger for recognition, a hunger for love, a hunger for acceptance, whatever it is, can be found in the person of Jesus. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry again. And whoever believes in me will never be thirsty again. And Jesus says, I am the bread of life. And that word, I am, he's also referring to that time when Moses, when God called Moses to go to Pharaoh. And Moses says, who should I say your name is? What do I tell the people who you are? And God says, I am who I am. And that's what Jesus is referring to again. I am. And I am, it's a double. It's like I am. It actually repeats itself. There's two Greek words for that. But Jesus is, if you had to translate it directly to today's language, Jesus would be saying, I am the bread of life. I am the bread of life. And so like these people, we need some other kind of bread to sustain us, spiritual food that we can get from Jesus. And we may not even realize it, but Jesus says, I am the bread of life. What we really need is a relationship with Jesus. You know, when you go to a restaurant, and what happens is when we begin to feast on Jesus or look to him to sustain us, all the other breads, all those other things we look to take their rightful place. You know, when you go to a restaurant, say you go to a restaurant and you're waiting now, you haven't ordered yet, and they bring you those little fresh little bread rolls. You know, they're warm and they lack it, and you open it up and you eat them. You're not gonna have 20 of those. You might have one or two, even if you're hungry. Why? Because you know what's coming, right? You're gonna order a big meal, but you're not gonna fill yourself up on the bread rolls. You might just eat it and enjoy it, but you know what's coming, that whatever steak that you've ordered or that fish and chips that you've ordered, you know that that's coming. That's what's gonna sustain you. And so what happens is when Jesus takes his rightful place, we can enjoy the other breads. You can enjoy your job and you can enjoy your relationships. You can enjoy those things, but you know at the end of the day, ultimately what is truly gonna sustain you, and that's the meal that is to come, and that's Jesus, to look to him to sustain us. Remember when Jesus was tempted in the desert? Again, he had been fasting for 40 days. And the Bible says the devil comes to him and says, hey, if you are the Son of God, tell these stones to become bread. Look after yourself, man. Just satisfy yourself immediately. And Jesus says, man doesn't live on bread alone, but from every word that comes from the mouth of God. I want to leave us with three things this morning, and then we're going to break bread together as a church. The ushers will come around a bit later, and we're going to spend some time just reminding ourselves that actually, Jesus, you are the bread of life. And as we break bread this morning, I remind myself that I need to feast on you. I need to look to you for all my needs. So number one, quite simple and obvious, but number one is we all need Jesus. That's what Jesus was saying. You need me. And it's quite a simple statement, but an obvious one. But I think so often, if I look at my own life, I don't live my life as if I need Jesus, right? I live my life like, I've got this. I can do this. I've got it together. I'll figure it out. I'll do it. Yeah, I need Jesus, you know, he's there when I need him. But actually, do I live my life as if I really need Jesus? In my husbanding, in my parenting, in my being a friend, in my being a leader, in my just being a son, or am I feasting on Jesus? Do I live my life as if I need Jesus? There was an Australian doctor, James Scott. He went missing in the Himalayan mountains. He survived for 43 days, no food. Freezing cold, 43 days, imagine that. Himalayan mountains, 43 days, no food. He just lived off ice. That snow that had melted and he drank. That's 43 days. That's a long time. They reckon maybe 60 days maximum you can live without food. And my encouragement to us today, there's the food, this bread that Jesus is offering. We don't have to go hungry. We can feast on him. And it's interesting that death came into the world through eating. Remember Adam and Eve? Death came to the world through eating. But life comes through the world through eating and feasting on Jesus. We need Jesus. It's a simple reminder, but it's an invitation. God, I need you. I want to remind myself. So we all need him. The good news is we can all have him. You know when you know you need something or you want something and you think you can't get it? You can have Jesus. The Bible says, Jesus said, I tell you the truth. Moses didn't give you the bread from heaven. My Father did. And now he offers you the true bread from heaven. The true bread of God is the one who comes down from heaven and gives life to the world. John 3:16 and 17 says, for this is how God loved the world. He gave his one and only Son so that everyone who believes in him will not perish but have eternal life. God sent his Son into the world not to judge the world but to save the world through him. The Bible says that he offers you the true bread from heaven. And this manna, like the manna in the Old Testament that was just put on the ground, it was for everyone. It wasn't a special group of people. Anybody could come. Anybody could come and just pick it up, eat it, and be satisfied. And the same is true with Jesus. We all have access to Jesus. I don't care where you're at, what studies, what qualifications you have, what qualifications you don't have, how disqualified you feel, how sinful you feel, how separated from God you feel. We all have access to Jesus. We need Jesus, and he makes himself available to every single one of us. And lastly, Jesus truly satisfies. He wants us to look to him to be satisfied, not to anything else, not to anyone else, but to him. Verse 34, they said, sir, give us this bread every day. And Jesus replied, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry again. Whoever believes in me will never be thirsty again. There's this promise that Jesus is making. If we eat of him, that we'll never be hungry again. Have you ever been to a restaurant and you look at the menu and you're thinking, wow, that looks amazing? Or you look at the menu and you see, oh, I want one of those, right? And then you order it and then it comes and you're like, there's something wrong here. Doesn't quite look like the picture, you know? Doesn't quite deliver. Jesus isn't like that. Jesus makes a promise. He's going to deliver that promise. If he says, if you come to me, you'll never be hungry again, he's not lying. He's not trying to trick us. He's not trying to con us. He's saying, if you come to me, you can find everything you need to satisfy your every need. For you to eat, something has to die, right? You eat a rump steak, a cow has to die. Right? You eat some bread, wheat has to die. Something has to die. It's either you die or that thing dies, right? If you don't eat, you're going to die. So it's you or the cow, or you or the bread. That's what it is. Huh? Or? Or the plants. No, don't eat plants. No. Some plants, maybe. Cauliflower burger or what? Who eats that? Anyway. For you to eat, something has to die. And this morning, there's a Savior who died for us, so we don't have to die. And if we eat of him, if we feast on him, if we enjoy him, we can live for all eternity. We're going to create a moment this morning now, just as I'm going to ask the ushers to come around. What I'd like us to do as we just break bread together is for us to be reminded of the promise that Jesus made, that he is the bread of life. He is the bread that sustains us. And I'm preaching to myself this morning as much as I'm preaching to you. I'm reminding myself time and time again, when I get frustrated or I get irritated or I get whatever it is, if I'm struggling, if I'm feeling down or negative or whatever it is, if I'm feeling like I'm lacking, if I'm feeling like I'm tired, I'm burdened, or whatever it is, I'm saying, God, let me sustain myself in you. I'm obviously feeding myself with things that aren't going to sustain me. But God, let me look to you this morning. Let us look to you this morning, Father, where there's a lack. If there's a hunger in your life, if there's a hunger in your heart, where there's this empty space, I'm trusting that God would come and fill that. And you would be reminded this morning that God wants to come and satisfy those needs. So the ushers, they're coming around, they're going to hand out the juice and the bread. But as they do that, if you're here this morning and you don't know Jesus, and I don't mean Jesus as in this word, this name, this person that you've heard about. Maybe you've come to church 100 times. I don't know. Maybe you haven't. Maybe this is your first time with us today. Maybe you don't know this Jesus. But I want to ask you, how long do you think you can last without food? How long? 43 days? If you don't know Jesus, there's a Savior here who invites you to himself and saying, come, come to me. I am the bread of life. Not just ordinary bread, not just random, I'm the bread of life. And he invites us to himself. Why? If you don't know Jesus today, why go hungry? There's the bread of life that is offered you to you today. Why go hungry? Why not take of that bread? And if you do know Jesus, if you do know God, maybe you're in a place like where the Israelites were. They had become dissatisfied with this manna, dissatisfied with God. God, I know you, but I've become a bit dissatisfied with you. You haven't really quite lived up to my expectations, or you haven't quite delivered as I wanted you to deliver. And I want to encourage you this morning, if you're in that place where you're feeling a bit dissatisfied, I want to encourage you to slow down this morning, to take a moment this morning, and to savor Jesus and to enjoy him. And may this be a start. May today for you, may today be a start of a journey where God reveals himself to you more and more in a deeper and in a greater, a meaningful way. So as the ushers come around, we're going to break bread this morning. If you don't know Jesus, I want to encourage you, man, just do some business with God in your heart this morning. You don't have to pray a special prayer. You don't just repeat after me. You don't have to stand up. You don't have to come to the front. But if God is knocking on your door today, if God is knocking on your heart today, you'll know. You'll know if he is. You'll know if he's working in your heart. I want to encourage you, open up your heart to him this morning. And for us, if you do know Jesus, can we take a moment just to allow him to come and encourage and speak and remind us that actually, God, you are the bread of life. And forgive me for where I've looked elsewhere. Forgive me where I've looked for my sustenance or my strength elsewhere. Forgive me for where I've tried to, you know, fill that hunger with something or someone else. I want to turn my attention to you again this morning, Lord, and I want to say, come. Come and speak, come and breathe, come and work. So, yeah, you can get together with people around you, families or groups or whatever. We're gonna play a song on the screen just for some background worship. And can we just take a moment this morning as we just remind ourselves, Jesus, thank you that you are the bread of life, and we come to you this morning. And then afterwards, I'm going to wrap it up with the prayer. So can we just spend some time this morning just enjoying Jesus and thanking him for his body and his blood.
scarce can take it in, that on the cross my burden gladly buried, he bled and died to take away my sins. It seems my soul, my Savior God, how great thou art, how great thou art. It seems my soul, my Savior, how great thou art, how great thou art. In Christ shall come with shouts of acclamation and take me home, but joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration, and then proclaim, my God, how great thou art. You sing to my soul, my Savior God, to me.
Thank you, Lord. Father, thank you, Jesus. You call yourself the bread of life. And we thank you, Father, that you sustain us, that you keep us, that you hold us, that you walk with us, that you lead us, that you love us, that you care for us, Lord, that you provide for us, Lord Jesus. And Father, I pray as we leave this place, Lord, may we be reminded, Lord, that we can find our sustenance, we can find our strength, our nourishment, and everything, Lord, in you, Father. And I pray, Lord, when we feel those hunger pains coming, let us be reminded, actually, I need to be looking to Jesus. So may we do that, Lord, I pray. In your name, amen. Amen. Thank you, church. Thanks for coming out. Please don't rush off. Grab a cup of coffee. Love to catch up. Have a good week. We'll see you guys around.